Good morning. I am glad that each of you are here, and wherever you are on your life journey, your story, your questions, your concerns, may this be a place, a peace for you in this time that we gather for worship. For those of you who know our tradition of lighting a candle, for those who've died in our congregation, we have two this week, Helen McKay, who some of you know well. Others of you may not know her, but she was that quiet woman that sat in the back and helped with the lighting. She died on Thursday. Her service will be next Sunday at 2:30 here in the sanctuary. The other person who died at 1:30 last night is Don Medland. He had been ill for just a while, and his family was able to be with him, and he died peacefully. So we light a candle to remember the saints that are in our midst, and the saints that have gone before us, and the ways in which we celebrate their lives and their presence amongst us. I want to introduce to you someone who's quite special, and you have a treat this morning. Our person who is going to be doing the sermon is Jane Dawson. And Jane, if you'd stand, you may not know Jane as well, because she's at the 9 o'clock service faithfully. And she is a spiritual director, so she's been part of people's spiritual journeys as she meets with them individually, an educator, and you have your doctoral degree in adult education. And has been such a gift. She's serving on the Worship and Christian Education Development Committee. So you'll be hearing from her. The other thing to know is if you look in your bulletin, under Coming Attractions in February, she will be leading a six-week series on engaging the scriptures. And it's on Tuesday mornings, 9:30 to 11, guaranteed to be an amazing experience as it's not lecture form, but it's an opportunity for everybody to share it together.
Yeah, it's a learning circle in adult education. We always meet and talk in a circle, so it'll be really using that tradition and following one reading from the lectionary each week for those 6 weeks as we go along. And it's open invitation for anybody to come for as many sessions as you can come for. So on a drop-in basis, no registration required. So sort of if it works in your schedule, you're welcome there.
Fabulous. Thank you. And I invite Emily McDonald to come forward. I know I saw her. Oh, there she is. We're going to take a moment to thank those who were a part of Epiphany in helping it to happen. Before we thank all the other volunteers, we wanted to say thank you because Emily chaired this huge event. It's a lot of work, and we want to say thank you.
Oh, thank you so much.
They're beautiful. Thank you so much. And I just wanted to take a minute. Oops, did I drop my paper? I wanted to thank all the volunteers and the planning committee members of Epiphany for all their great work this past year. And I had a list of them just to let you know who they were, and I must have dropped it. Marilyn's going to bring it to me. Yeah. This is the planning committee, and they've worked with me for the past year to do this. So just to let you know who's on that committee and what their roles are, and you can thank them too. So we have the secretary, and also for the brochure and program editor. I'm getting feedback. Is that all right? Penny Bond. I don't know if Penny's here. I'll just ask you to stand if you're here. The vendor coordinator, Sharon McDonald. The registrar, Katya Ramanasiva. Presenter arrangements, Denise Holman. Promotions coordinator, Joan Mason. Host volunteers and media, Al Fowler. Hospitality, Nikki Sakutis. Registration, Vanessa Hammond from Fairfield United. Information desk, Barb Langton and Ruth Radslaff. First aid, Bruce Holvick from Vancouver. Special needs, Jan McArdle from Oak Bay United. Tech support, Brent Parrish. Online registration, Roman Ramiansiva. Brochure, programs and graphics, Jane Louie. Sound, Jim Anderson. And lighting, and for the first time in a number of years, we didn't have Helen Mackay. Prayer coordinator, Adina Malcolm. Our place liaison, Don Evans. Members at large, Rennie Warburton and Mandy Wilson from St. Aidan's. Signage, Forrest Nelson. Social action, Janet Gray. Musician liaison, Barry Rolston. Parking coordinator, Joan Mason. Ministry team liaison, Tammy Kelly, and custodian, Cullen Morton. So you can see there's a lot of people involved in the planning, but also there are a lot of people connected to those people who do the behind the scenes stuff. So there's a lot of people that are involved and made it another great success. So I just want you to thank those people. Thank you.
I might have missed it, but did I hear hospitality? Heather, was it? Yeah. I don't always hear everything. I also want to take just a moment. Is Dorothy Zilke here? She's not. I just want to acknowledge on February 11th that she will be 97 years old. So if you know her, send her a card or send her a greeting. And with that, I invite Alec Ford to come and... No, I'm sorry. I don't have my... Just a minute. You can tell I don't do this all that often. A time of silence. Let's see. We use the singing bowl as a way to help us to settle our spirits and be present in this time and to have that sense of the divine in our midst. And Stephanie, if you would help us light the Christ candle. Each Sunday as we gather, we remind each other that Christ is in our midst, and that we are the light of the world. Thanks.
My aunt's not here.
And now, Alec, invitation to worship.
We have gathered to worship God. We have come to open ourselves to the power of God's word in our midst.
We have come to offer up questions, doubts, fears, and challenges that burden our hearts.
We have come to God's people.
Join with me in prayer. Companioning God, if you would join with me. Companioning God, you are the very essence of wisdom and grace. We come today to learn and grow, that we may be a reflection of your spirit in all that we say, in all that we do, and in all that we are. Amen. And now it's time for young people. If you'd join me up front here. Come on down. I'm going to try to do this. Oh! Is this heavy? Who knows what this is? It's a book. It's a big book. It's a Bible. Now, did you ever notice that there's a Bible that sits on up there on our communion table? This is it. Now, this is a very old book. A very big book, and it's the Bible. And look at, we're going to stop on this page. It says, am I doing something? Let me readjust just a moment. This was given in memory. Can anyone read that? It's hard because it's in that really gothic print, but it says Janet
Swift.
Close, Janet Strait. And what year was it given? 1943. Who was born in 1943? Okay, we might have to look out at the congregation. Who was here in 1943? Look at, there's a couple of folks. Look at, as you look out there. Why do you think we have a Bible? Right there. Sitting in front all the time. There's a lot of Bibles around this church. I'm going to tell you a little story, okay? When I was a kid and about 8 years old, any 8-year-olds here? Oh, perfect. When I was 8 years old, my job was to dust at home. Anyone else have that chore? You did just do dusting? All right. So we had this big old Bible that sat on the coffee table in the middle of our living room, and the only time I could touch it was when I was dusting. So I always thought this Bible is very special. It was a very important book. And one day I went to a garage sale and I saw in a pile of books a Bible. It was a little one. It wasn't this big old one. And it was only a nickel. Only a nickel. To have a Bible, a very special book, for a nickel. Now, on my limited income, which wasn't a whole lot at 9 years old, a nickel was a lot of money. But I really wanted that Bible. So I went up to the woman who was there, and I said, I'd like to buy this. And I handed her my nickel. And she said, dear, for you, it's free. And she handed me my nickel back. And I thought I was the most special person in the entire world. And I went home that night, and I started reading from the very first page. But I didn't get very far, because there's a lot of big words, and a lot of things I didn't quite understand. So I am grateful today that we have people like our Sunday school teachers, because that's who helped me understand what this big old heavy book, this Bible, is all about. And I'm glad that you're here, that you have a chance to learn, because all these words in here, I can sum up in one sentence, and that is that God loves you, and so do we. Okay? It's time to go off to learn more about what's in this book with your Sunday school teachers. And would the Sunday school teachers stand? I want to say a special thank you to you all. Okay.
The scripture this morning is from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 20. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of these, the least of these commandments, and teaches others to do the same, will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is part of our story.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
wonderful to be with you this morning. As Tammy said, I'm usually with the 9 o'clock service, so it's wonderful to see some other faces connected to First Met. And another thing that Tammy didn't mention, that is also as an educator, I'm also a lifelong learner. So I'm speaking today as a part of, as a student at Vancouver School of Theology, and today is Vancouver School of Theology's so-called Theology Sunday. So various VST people are out preaching and talking about the programs at VST. So in addition to speaking now, I've got a table of brochures and programs describing events at VST for anybody who's interested at coffee hour afterwards. You are the salt of the earth, says the reading from today's gospel. And when you think about it, it doesn't sound like much. In fact, coming in here, there was an icy morning, there was salt just thrown out onto the sidewalks as we came in. So it's thrown out onto the sidewalks, and otherwise it's just an everyday little thing, an ordinary kitchen or household staple. And apart from its usefulness with ice, these days salt has a bad reputation. Doctors warn us to stay away from salt. Low salt is a good thing we look for on food labels. Too much salt is bad for us. Or at least that's this year's dietary wisdom. Who knows what they'll tell us next year. So, salt of the earth, no thanks. But in the ancient world, when the gospel was written, salt was rare and valuable for its ability to enhance taste, among other things. Sometimes it was even used as currency. Some claim that the word salary comes from the Latin word sal, referring to a Roman soldier's allowance to buy salt. The expression to be worth your salt reflects the same idea, where salt is something good, held in high esteem. So if salt loses its taste, it loses its value. It becomes worthless. Without its saltiness, as the gospel says, it is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. It's a good metaphor for thinking about a number of things that used to hold value, but have lost their value over time, have become trivial or unimportant, or, like salt, even considered bad for you. Some people think that way about the Bible. The Bible, it may have been valuable to people a long time ago, or even a generation ago. For them, because they didn't know any better, didn't have the experts to tell them otherwise, it offered something meaningful about how to think about the creation of the universe, about how to behave toward other people, about how to make sense of the world and their place in it. But these days, or so this kind of thinking goes, we've moved on from all of that. The Bible is outdated. It's hard to read, as Tammy said. Not just when you're 9 or 8. In lots of places, it's either really boring or even to our modern sensibilities, pretty nonsensical. Just flipping it open to a passage of Leviticus, say, or Revelation, and we're in a world where it's easy to wonder what on earth these words, this book, might have to say to us now. It's also inconsistent in many places, where different versions of events contradict each other. And then there are the dogmatic, unforgiving, scoldy parts where we might bristle at being told what to do. As in the passage today, where Matthew has Jesus caution us that unless our righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, we will never enter the kingdom of heaven. So righteousness seems hardly within reach in this reading, and the punishment goes on forever if we don't measure up. And there are also parts of the Bible that are, to our eyes, pretty offensive. The Bible says things that strike us as patriarchal, misogynistic, homophobic, anti-Semitic. It takes slavery for granted as normal and acceptable. It has many passages where even God condones terrible acts of violence and genocide. For instance, in Joshua's conquest of Jericho, when God tells the Israelites to destroy the whole city and kill everyone, including the women and children. There's some pretty grisly stuff. So no wonder a number of people, not just outside Christianity, but within the Christian community, have gone off the Bible. Like salt. Either the salt of Scripture has lost its value, or maybe it never even had any in the first place, and we, in our supposed more enlightened times, now finally have the knowledge and courage to say so. In any event, we now know better, that its consumption should be reduced or avoided at all costs. Or, at the very least, it should come with a warning label. 9 out of 10 doctors say, too much scripture is harmful for your health. Especially in these times, when the church, including the United Church of Canada, is aging, and many say weakening through declining numbers and influence. Doesn't that make it all the more imperative to let go of that outmoded, unpalatable baggage, particularly that hoary old Bible, and make the message of the church more relevant, more accessible, more in tune with the times? Let's focus on spiritual growth and social justice, but the Bible, well, apart from a few great parables and psalms, it's just too antiquated to have much vital to say anymore. And there are things to be said for this point of view. And I have to admit, it's a way of thinking that not long ago would have been close to my own. But over the past few years, for reasons I'm not sure I can yet even put into words, I've come to a quite different view about the centrality of the Bible and its value for the future of the church, wherever that future might be leading us. If the church must change or die, as the well-known phrase by John Shelby Spong sums up the perilous state of things, perhaps the direction of change isn't to chuck out the old biblical stuff in favor of something more contemporary, as some might suggest, but rather to go back to the scriptural basics, boning up on our own story, an ancient book, looking at it again with renewed attention. Let's go back to Matthew. After starting with salt, Jesus then switches his metaphor. You are the light of the world, he goes on. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. From salt to light. The salt might lose its flavor, but the source of the light never goes out, even when it is covered up and we lose touch with the power of its brightness. So going back to the perceived relevance or irrelevance of the Bible to the church and the world today, just because it's old and foreign to our current way of understanding doesn't mean it should necessarily be put aside or has lost its capacity to be an important source of illumination as we, as a church, find our uncertain way forward. The Bible as salt that has lost its flavor and needs to be chucked, or the Bible as a lamp that needs to be taken out from where it has been covered up so its light can brighten up the darkness around us. Back to today's reading. Jesus goes on, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. I have come not to dispense with the old, in other words, but to engage it in new ways." Like the church that arose in his name, Jesus in his time, just like us in ours, also grappled with the problem of what to do with the tradition into which he was born. A tradition which he upheld, but also challenged. A tradition about which he also might have said, as some say today, that if it is to be true to its own teachings, the heart of faith must undergo a radical change. And how? I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. What does that mean? Not just what did that mean for Jesus in his time, which is a question that merits many sermons of its own, but what does it mean for us now as the still standing but admittedly straggling remnants of a shrinking church? What is it that we are here to fulfill? And how might we read Scripture, our central story, as a light that can help us stay alive to our purpose and mission and keep moving towards whatever that fulfillment might be? The Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann makes an observation that I find quite helpful. What we are doing when we read the Bible, he says, when we study it, when we really dig into it, when we work to interpret its many layers, paradoxes, contradictions, and complexities, is reimagining the world. For all its difficulties, what Scripture gives us is another world, an alternative vision of reality. It gives us a way of seeing the world and our place in it that resists simple answers, for one thing. And it gives us a sense of possibility that radically challenges the taken-for-granted world around us. The world of tweets, of the 1%, the world of mass shootings, global warming, executive orders to ban refugees, consumer capitalism, escapist entertainment, the corrupting influence of money and power. It gives us a world rich in symbol and metaphor, always, all the way from Genesis to Revelation, with an eye to deeper life. Even the most troubling, uncomfortable parts invite us into a dialogue with the essence of our being that challenges the prevailing economic reality. The strange new world of the Bible, as it has been called by the theologian Karl Barth, its very strangeness beckons us into the presence of divine mystery that asks us to look beyond our habitual blinkers and distractions and preoccupations. That does not mean reading the Bible uncritically and taking it as a book of unquestionable facts. It does not mean subscribing to the Bible as the literal and inerrant Word of God. It means going back to Scripture as a kind of homing ground, you might say, where we can really ask ourselves, both together and personally, what it is we are doing as a church, where we came from, where we are going, and what it is we truly are here to fulfill. It means diving deep into its structure and language to get a new perspective on what is core here, what is pulsing at the heart of it, what gave this book life then in the times when it was written and compiled, but also what are the meanings we can draw from it now that speak to our own lives and troubles. It means arguing with it, doubting it, being provoked by it, and sometimes even hating parts of it and saying so without apology. As Christians, who are we? What do we believe? What are we good for in times like these? These are difficult questions in difficult times. The Bible does not offer easy answers that we can just look up and quote verbatim. But it does offer a vitally important partner in exploration, where we can dig for our own interpretations, individually and collectively, in dynamic conversation with the shaping stories of our past and the pressing questions of our future. You are the salt of the earth, says Jesus. You are the light of the world. And I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. Maybe we could think of the Bible as both salt and light to help us on our journey towards whatever we are here to fulfill. It has not lost its taste. We just have to savor it in new ways. It has not lost its light, although that light may have been buried under the bushel basket of narrow, dogmatic, and limiting approaches to interpretation. Let's open it up and read it with fresh eyes as a place not to look for fixed answers, but to engage with our deepest, most perplexing life questions. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jane, for that wonderful reminder of the foundation of Scripture in our lives here in this community and our individual lives. And now, as an act of thanksgiving, we give back just a portion of all that we have, both financially, but in terms of our time, our talent, our energies, our imagination, we give back. Invite you to join our hearts, our minds, and our spirits in prayer. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for the gift of this day, for opportunities to be renewed, encouraged, and challenged in your spirit. Thank you that this is a day filled with opportunities to learn, to engage our hearts and minds so that we may grow into new possibilities of how we are and who we are in our world. We can be challenged to find ways to express love in a world of hate, to live out your wildly inclusive love in a world that we hear more and more about who is in or who is acceptable and who is not. As a people of the Christian tradition, we study scriptures and other texts. As we do this, we ask for your help to open our minds, to provide us with curiosity, and not to just settle for easy answers, but to struggle and find ways to be faithful in interpreting the text in its historical, cultural, spiritual, and literary context, so that we have a deeper understanding. May we have open hearts as we seek to understand scriptures as they relate to our lives and our world today. We're grateful for life lessons learned, even when we don't enjoy them. And we're grateful for opportunities to learn them again, sort of. But thank you that you don't give up on us, because we aren't always good at remembering our lessons the first time around. May we have open spirits, that we listen carefully to our own call to be a faithful witness of your love and justice. May we be a reflection of Jesus among us all. And with open hearts this day, we remember those in special need. We remember the family and friends of Helen Mackay and Don Medland for their faithful witness to you. We pray for Don Inkeman, Don Duke, Ross and Pat McKinnon, Brian Wilkinson, and David Chamberlain. We pray for those individuals who are on our hearts today. In a time of silence, we lift them to you. God, we add to those prayers the mass shootings, those who have died, those who grieve, those who are seriously injured, for those whose lives were forever changed. For Muslims across this land who fear for their own safety, may we find our way to peace. You know there are many other concerns of this world of ours. We lift them up and we trust that even in times when we are discouraged, even in times when we wonder what is happening next, what is our future, we remind ourselves that no matter what, we are held in your love. In your grace we pray. Amen.
And since we've been talking about the Bible, today's word of blessing is taken from 1 Thessalonians, at least most of it is. Go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you and remain with you always. Amen.